I have a serious question. It's about pets. You said some years ago that people are becoming robots' pets. So are you ready to become such a pet?
Okay.
Bitcoin. You're the smartest guy in this room.
Bitcoin. I had about 15 Bitcoin, and it was worth less than I bought. And I don't ever check the price of things. I'm not a financial person. I don't try to pay attention to my bank accounts or anything. And all of a sudden, I saw it was way up in value. But seven of them got stolen from the company that was holding them for me. Somebody bought them with a credit card and then canceled the credit card payments and bought out all their Bitcoin. So I lost seven of them. I have some Ethereum as well. But I don't do it as an investment. I do it so I could play with it and see how to use it. I have bought things online with my Bitcoin, and I have apps that told me all the places, if I go to a city, how to find the hotels, the restaurants, the convenience stores, all the places that might accept Bitcoin, because I want to someday travel and live just on Bitcoin and nothing else. As far as robots, yeah, robots that we build robots to take care of all our needs in life, all of our computers take care of it for us. And it's like someday, maybe we won't have to do hardly anything at all. We won't hardly even have to work and we'll be taken care of. That's like a family dog. And so I start feeding my dog really good human food because I want to be treated well if I'm ever a pet hundreds of years from now.
So do you think that in the next 10, 15 years, we're going to see a big turning point in human history regarding the, I'm speaking of this in the context of AI, machine learning, the AI will be smarter than us, self-driving cars, I'm talking about jobs, financial status of each individual.
Yeah, life is about happiness, and happiness is smiles minus frowns. If you're always worried about what's coming next, it might be downfall, jobs might go away. That's just going to give you more frowns. So I don't like to do that. The worrying and the scare tactics are here every bit of our lives. People got very worried 200 years ago when they learned how to make cheap clothing in Manchester, England. Oh, the machines will never be fired, but the people will. Hey, we just transition jobs into other aspects where they're more needed. I do not believe that artificial intelligence is intelligence. I believe it's still very artificial. It's simulated. It's just pretend intelligence, and it will not be able to take over and think on its own without humans. We've never thought of a machine to sit down and say, I'm a machine, what should I do today? What would be fun to do? What would be helpful to do? Never once. Only people have programmed them, and we've never talked about building that machine. There's this idea that you can't predict if it will happen after we reach singularity. Singularity is defined by Ray Kurzweil as the point at which the machines can process as much information as a human brain. But the trouble is, we don't know how the human brain is configured. Processing that much information, it's like having a big processor with no software that knows how to organize it.
So we can stay at home playing the games.
Oh, got that.
I don't worry about the artificial intelligence.
You can see yourself a slave of technology, and if so, what technology is more important?
I consider myself very much humanistic, thinking that really the world is, I've always thought, is in my brain and my ability to think. And I want the human, I grew up as a human. I want to be able to have my own thoughts and my private thoughts and say things to people and do things in a human way and not be hindered by technology. I am feeling more and more that technology is so important in our lives. Were we slaves to cars once we had them? You could argue, yeah, we were slaves to cars, but we never felt like slaves. We don't feel like slaves with our technology yet, even though we are kind of addicted and we have to do things in the way they're done. What I like is when a human being can act the way a human being acts, speaking, handwriting, whatever human beings do normally. I like speaking to my devices. When I have to follow structure and tap here and tap there and tap there and tap there, I'm following a structure that was defined by other human beings. They're artifacts, it's like rituals, and I don't believe in that. I just want to be back away from the technology as much as I can. I try to do it deliberately.
Thank you.
Would say that they are slaves to technology right now, but you know what, it goes unseen. You don't see an addiction.
Petri,
sure, if you could next.
What was the Steve Jobs philosophy that convinced you to start a business together and that helped Apple to become
Yeah, sure.
Second question. Do you consider there is a difference between Apple's philosophy by now and Apple's philosophy by the time when Steve Jobs was running the company?
I missed a word in the last one, but I'm going to go back to your first question. It's actually, all the ideas for the product that was going to be all of Apple's revenues for the first 10 years of the company were in my head and created by me alone. And Steve Jobs didn't know about them. For 5 years, as a good friend, he'd come into town about once a year, see something that I invented, and he would turn it into money for both of us. That was his role, was as a salesman. He had no money. I had a job as an engineer. You can see the difference. As far as starting personal computers, that was all my thinking. This is the revolution that's coming. This is my part in it. This is what it's going to do for people. Education. I pleaded with him for 2 hours to give our first Apple I to a woman that would take the computer into schools and teach young kids how to use it. And he made me buy it for $300, and I had to give it to her. So originally he was not the inspiration for the company and what it stood for. That came later on.
But the Apple philosophy, not Steve Jobs philosophy, the Apple philosophy now and then.
Apple what?
Philosophy.
Philosophy. Apple philosophy. Oh, our philosophy was to build great products. Steve Jobs felt that way too, and he could recognize it. He didn't understand technology. So he had a problem building great computers. He could eventually build a great iPhone. And that was when Apple soared, his fortune soared with Apple, and he started bringing us a world of, you know, we respected him greatly for bringing us a whole new lifestyle. He saw that. He could see closed products, but not computers. Anything that's not a computer, a phone, smartphone, how it works with people and how it operates with you, yes. Even a Macintosh, how it looks on a screen, it was just a program to look like a computer. It wasn't deep inside a computer. So that was the Steve Jobs when he returned to Apple that we really admire and praise the most. Except a lot of us heard the early visionary statements. He was a very good speaker in terms of deeper thoughts, deeper inside of humanity, what it's worth, where we are going as a species. He was very good expressing those views that we all believe in, just not making the products that would make them happen until iPod and then iPhone.
Thank you.
One more question from my side.
I'm Roman Sopra from Business Review. How do you believe that technology changed the human brain? And what was the main challenge in your profession and how you surpassed it?
Please repeat the question.
So, how did the technology change the human brain? And what was the main challenge in your profession and how did you surpass it?
I don't think technology changes a human brain very much. I think human brains adapt to anything, any environment that they're in, and they are currently in the environment of technology because we use technology continually. We start to think that sometimes the answers are always there in our devices, and maybe it's less impetus to be able to come up with a lot of the answers ourselves. I think that's been one of the biggest changes. It's also made us feel very good about life. For example, used to read a lot of books about super people that could do more than anything else. I created my products to make people more powerful than they could be without them. Well, now when you hold a smartphone, you're more powerful than any superhero in any of the comics that's ever been. I mean, you could just tap buttons and cause amazing things to happen that they never imagined.
Okay,
and your challenge, the biggest challenge in your profession, and how did you surpass it?
I never really had any great big challenges. I had prepared for so many years with project after project after project that was just magic pouring out of me. Every single project I took on, I did really well. And that's all. I don't know how to explain it. I look back and I wouldn't change a thing. Wouldn't redo anything differently.
Vlad, one question?
Not talking about Bitcoins as a coin, as a currency, but as blockchain technology. What do you think
blockchain technology is going to impact fields that we can't even discuss right now, just like personal computers and smartphones interface, it changed our life in ways that we could not have said when they were first introduced. Bitcoin technology will almost every business that runs on transactions, that includes banks, it includes airlines, it includes grocery stores, it includes online shopping, every one of these is a candidate for blockchain technology that sort of disperses the ledger everywhere and not just in one ownership, one company that runs it all in their computer. And the change might happen slowly in some cases, fast in others, but it's going to impact social things that we do in our life, and maybe we want payments to not go to certain directions. So I'm a big fan of the blockchain technology. It's something that was hard to get a grasp on at first, but it's going to be very, very important. At first I thought it's just cryptocurrencies, but I'm seeing so many people around the world right now developing blockchain solutions. That's what I would study first and foremost if I was an engineering student.
Thank you.